Welcome to the Ebenezer Estridge Moravian Church. We pray that this time of worship will be a blessing to you. Please listen attentively to the following as it would aid in your comfort and safety with us. Always sanitize your hands upon entry into and exit from the sanctuary. As you enter, kindly allow an usher to guide you to your seat. We ask that you wear your mask at all times. If you feel the need to remove your mask, we recommend that you leave the sanctuary quietly, find a private place, and remove your mask using the straps. Do not touch your body, especially your face. Take deep breaths and relax for a moment before returning. Before exiting the bathroom, kindly wash your hands thoroughly for 20 seconds while adhering to the correct hand washing protocols. Be reminded to sanitize your hands upon re-entry into the sanctuary. Avoid touching surfaces. Do not share hymn books, Bibles, or materials of any kind. Do not shake hands or hug anyone. You may extend your hand in greeting, but refrain from touching. We know that the Lord is indeed calling you, but we can assure you not on your cell phone. So kindly select the silent or vibrate mode. We now invite you to remain reflective as we worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
Good morning, church. The watchword for the week says, bear fruits worthy of repentance. This comes from Luke chapter 3 and verse 8. Again, it reads, bear fruits worthy of repentance. Luke chapter 3 and verse 8. Let us all stand as we seek to begin this morning's act of worship. You, Lord God, are our strength and our song, and we trust in you.
Together we joyfully sing, thank the Lord, praise his name.
You, wonderful God, are our liberator, our freedom and our joy.
Together we gladly sing, for the Lord has done wonderful things.
You, trustworthy God, are the wonderful source of all kindness and mercy. So let creation and all humanity join together in thankful songs.
Together we freely sing. See, God has come to save us. We will trust in God and not be afraid. The Lord God is our strength and our song. Amen.
Amen. And as we are gathered here this morning, let us unite our voices in the singing of or hymn 151, Thy Kingdom Come on Bended Knee.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Today, we will light the first two candles of the Advent wreath, the candle of hope and the candle of peace. Come. Now we light the third candle of Advent. This is the candle of joy. As the coming of Jesus, our Savior, draws nearer, our joy builds with our anticipation of his birth. Together,
we joyfully praise you, Lord. For the fulfillment of your promise of a Savior and what that means in our lives. Thank you for the gift of salvation through the birth of your Son, Jesus. Create us anew as we wait and help us to see your glory as you fill our lives with your living spirit. Amen.
Together we shall sing, "Be still and know that I am God." Stand as we go through the liturgy for the third Sunday in Advent. This is found on page 91 of the liturgy book. Page 91 of the liturgy book, the third Sunday of Advent. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love.
He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to praise him for his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved.
Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.
Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already. He came to call not the righteous, but sinners to repentance.
His divine power has given us everything needed for life and godliness.
As a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in Christ, things in heaven and things on earth.
We will sing, "I Cannot Tell Why He Whom Angels Worship." Continue. The Lord became flesh and lived among us.
We have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to those to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor."
Today the scripture has been fulfilled. He has given us the garland of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a vain spirit.
Wherever he went, into villages, cities, or farms, people at once recognized him and brought the sick on mats and laid them in the marketplace.
They begged that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed.
Heavenly Father, creator of heaven and earth, to you belong all praise and glory. We thank you for your unspeakable gift of grace and for the lifelong example of your Savior's obedience. We showed obedience by the things he suffered, and through his death, he made eternal life available to all believers. Merciful Father, as we celebrate his advent, and as we live in expectation of his second coming, grant that he may be born anew in our hearts to the praise and the glory of your grace through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Holy Child of Bethlehem, you are Lord. We worship and adore your name. You came as a babe in a manger, but you are the King of all ages. May your pure and blameless existence be the test and aim of our lives. You, O Lord, were born of a woman, and yours was a full, devoted, and consecrated life, surrendered in love to the Father. As you sought only the peace of the Father, as you grew in favor with God and humanity, grant us the will to surrender our own lives in love and through faith to be as devoted. Grant us the power through your Holy Spirit for your name's sake.
Amen.
Let us all stand as we continue. In confessing our sins in true repentance,
we learn that we are saved by grace through faith.
In dying to self and worldly passions,
we learn that life in all fullness is hidden in God in Christ.
In our willingness to forgive the wrongs of others,
we learn to cherish the reality of sins we forgive and are assured of God's forgiveness.
In being led by the Spirit of God,
we learn to discern the will of God and experience a foretaste of the life to come.
In being faithful to our earthly calling and the sovereign rule of God,
we learn patience through suffering and rejoice in hope of the surpassing glory of heaven.
In being born of God,
we learn to overcome the world through the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Come, my dear,
God of peace sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. A very hearty welcome is extended to all who are sharing in this act of worship this morning. There are no visitors in God's house, only family members whom we have not yet met. If this is your first time worshiping with us, welcome home. We are always glad to meet new members of God's family. So do we have anyone who we need to welcome home this morning? Do we have anyone who hasn't been here for a very long time? Or if you have been, this is the first time that you have been here. Could you please stand so that we can recognize you, please? All right, we're seeing some persons in our midst this morning. The mic is coming around, and so when it reaches you, I would like for you to state your name, and you can tell us where you're worshiping from. And if you have any relations with anyone in mansion or in this sanctuary.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Suzette, I'm sure everybody here knows me. Most people. Relative to Giselle, Treldy, well, the Bells family. I'm sorry, Addis. And this was my home church, so I had to come back and visit today.
Thank you.
I am Susan's brother. Mm-hmm. But I'm from Sandy Point. I'm a member of Emmanuel Methodist Church, and my name is James Buchanan.
Thank you, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Tira George Prince from Antigua, and Daddy Bell is my grandfather.
Thank you.
Angela Bell Roberts from St. Kitts, but living in Antigua. James Bell, a.k.a. Daddy Bell, is my father.
All right. Thank you very much. Let us give them a better round of applause than that. We need to welcome them in our midst. Thank you very much for being here with us this morning. As was stated earlier, there aren't any visitors in God's house, and so we warmly welcome you, family. We are happy that you did take the opportunity to be here with us today, and we do hope that you will enjoy the service this morning. Do we have anyone who is celebrating a birthday today? Anyone who is in sanctuary? All right, we have printed Riom Davis, who is celebrating today, and Sister Joanne Kelly, or Joanne Brown, as some of you may know her. She's also celebrating today. Sister Allison Williams will be celebrating on the 14th. Sister Jakima Johnson on the 15th. And Brother Leon Nata Nelson will also celebrate on the 15th. Not because we do not have them represented in church this morning. We will sing the birthday song, after which we will have... We have somebody? Oh, I'm sorry.
Huh? Oh.
I'm sorry. That is not on my paper. And Tanella, welcome. Is celebrating, and she's here, so it's quite fitting that we sing for all of our birthday celebrants this morning. After which we'll have Brother Sammy come forward, Ivan Williams will come forward and to bless the celebrants.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. Each day of the year, may you find. Happy birthday to you, the best that you ever had. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday.
have any anniversary celebrants?
Good morning, church. Let us pray. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of our birthday celebrants today. Father, we pray that they will continue to live with you, to live for you, and they will also continue to share your words. Father, we wish them a blessed day when they celebrate. Father, we ask a special blessing upon little Tanella. Father, we pray that her parents will continue to train her and bring her up in the knowledge of God. Father, all these, we ask your blessings. And these we ask in no other name, but your son's name. Amen.
Amen.
I crave your indulgence and ask you to listen to the few notices that are printed. Senior choir practice on Thursday at 7 p.m. Prayer meeting continues on Saturdays at 5:30 a.m. via the Zoom platform. The praise team practice will be on Saturday or every Saturday at 5:30 p.m. We continue to pray for our sick and shut-in members and all who are in mourning. We continue to keep in our prayers the Bell family on the passing of Brother James Bell. May God continue to be their guide and stay. The funeral service for our Brother James Bell will be held on Monday, 20th of December at 2 p.m. Monday, the 20th of December at 2 p.m. right here at Ebenezer. Our Christingle Candlelight and Children's Service will be held on Christmas Eve, which is Friday, the 24th of December at 7:30 p.m. Our Christingle or Candlelight Service, the Children's Service, will be held on Christmas Eve at Friday, the 24th of December at 7:30 p.m. Let us remember to walk with our candles. Those are all of the notices that I have before me at this time. Let us act in accordance as they concern us. We will now present our tithes and offerings unto God. But firstly, we must read the offertory sentence as is projected. Together, we make our offering today with joyful hearts, anticipating our celebration of God's gift to us in Christ Jesus. Know that our gifts may touch lives in deep
this season.
With the joy that we have received in Jesus' name. Amen. And while we present our gifts unto God, we will be blessed with an item of praise by the Estridge Brethren Chorale. Thank you. I think you can give us another round of applause. You have to encourage us, you know. You know, in most places, you don't really see the men. And so we are happy that we are in the house of God this morning. So let's give us another round of applause, please. Thank you very much. Encourage us as we continue to do the work of God.
Amen.
Let us all stand as we pray. Eternal God and loving Father, we thank you for yet another Sunday we can come into your house to worship you. God, we know that it is all about you, and without you we are nothing. If it weren't for you this morning, God, we would not be here. And so God, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you for yet another day. And God, we just want to thank you for the ability to go out to work. We thank you for the strength and the health that we were able to go out. And we also thank you for the mind that we are able to give you back a portion of what you deserve this morning. God, we just pray that you will just continue to bless us as a congregation, bless us individually, bless us, dear God, because this is what we need, and we are all dependent on you. God, we ask these things in your name, we pray. Amen. Now listen to God through the written and the spoken word. This morning, the Hebrew reading comes to us from Isaiah chapter 12, reading from verse 2 through to 6. The epistle reading, Philippians chapter 4, reading from verse 4 to 7. And the gospel reading comes to us from Luke chapter 3, verse 7 through to 18. The readers, please come forward.
Good morning, church. May we turn to Isaiah chapter 12, reading from verse 2 through to 6. Isaiah chapter 12, from verse 2 to 6. Here beginneth. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also is become my salvation. Therefore with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. And in that day shall ye say, Praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his doings among the people, make mention that his name is exalted. Sing unto the Lord, for he hath done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry out and shout, though inhabitant of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in the midst of thee. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The epistle reading is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Yes, good morning, church.
Good morning.
The gospel reading is taken from Luke 3, reading from verse 7 to 18. I'll be reading from the New Standard Version. Here beginning the reading. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of viper, who warned you to flee from the wrath? From the wrath to come, bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'You have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able to these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, as the axe is lying at the foot of the trees, every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." And the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" I reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with another who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers also asked him, and he said, "What shall we do?" He said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages." As the people were filled with expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the tongue of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear the threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." So, with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. This is the word of the Lord.
As we seek to prepare to receive from the word that was laid on our brother's heart, we will stand and we will sing some songs of preparation. The splendor of a king, you are God, reign, Jesus reign. Shall we all stand, please?
Majesty.
holy and righteous. You are God. You are God.
Thank you.
And good morning to Brother Zephaniah. I think you stepped in when we had the welcome, right? So welcome back to Estridge, Ebenezer. Nice seeing you once again. Also, Suzette, nice having you among us. Today is the third Sunday of Advent. And as we all know, Advent is a time for preparation. And that's why we're here, to praise our Almighty God. Father God, we thank you for who you are. Father, you are the splendor of a king. And Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who is reigning and who will ever reign until he is ready to come. Father, thank you for giving us receptive ears to listen to your words. Father, now speak to me as I speak to your people. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord. Amen. Amen. The watchword for today, Luke 3 verse 8, tells us, bear fruits worthy of repentance. Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Now, when John began preaching in the wilderness, a group of eager listeners gathered around him. The Israelites, they considered John to be a great prophet. And God had not sent a prophet to Israel for many, many years, for approximately 400 years. So the people, they were quite eager to listen to John. He was shouting in the wilderness, announcing the coming of the Lord. John was then the voice of God, spreading the important message, preparing a path for the Lord's coming. In preparation, we are to make a straight road for him. John's audience, the people in Israel who came to see the prophet in the wilderness, were faced with a life-changing message, because if they would prepare themselves, they would have to clear away the spiritual debris in their lives, such as greed, such as a selfish attitude. John realized that all were not sincere. Some were just pretenders, pretending that they were true believers. They had no hunger or thirst for righteousness. They wanted to be wrong and strong. And that's why John called them generation of vipers. John's message was addressed to those who were willing to confess their sins and encouraging them to be prepared for the coming of our Messiah. As we prepare for the King's return, we have to straighten out our lives through repentance, through a changed life from sins. And we all know we are sinners. And sin is missing the mark or falling short of God by disobedience, crime, hypocrisy, so forth. But there is forgiveness of sins, my brothers and sisters. Christ died to obtain it. Christ died to procure it. As Colossians chapter 1, verse 14 tells us, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. My brothers and sisters, we were bought from the slave market of sin. And the Lord Jesus placed a price tag on all of us. So highly he values us that he shed his own blood in order to bring us back to him. So since we have been bought with a tremendous cost, it should be clear to us that we no longer belong to ourselves, because we have been bought with a price. That's why we should not live our lives the way we choose. We should live our lives the way God wants us to live. We are to live God's way. If we repent of our sins, all of us will see the salvation sent from God, because salvation is for all of us, not just the Jews. John the Baptist calls on every humankind to be prepared, refers to all of us in this sanctuary, We are to be prepared to meet our Savior, to meet Jesus at his second coming. God's message has not changed since the Old Testament. It is still the same and remains the same. We will be judged for our unproductive lives. Just as a fruit tree is expected to bear fruit, just so we, God's people, should produce a crop of good deeds, good fruits. John said that people who claim to believe in God but do not live for God, they are like unproductive trees that will be cut down. John's preaching encouraged responses from the crowd. And many asked, what should we do in order to produce good fruit? And John responded, just show compassion, share with one another, show love, give to the poor. And this is the season of giving, remembering that no man is an island, no man stands alone, because we need one another, my brothers and sisters. John's message encouraged the tax collectors to change their lives because they were collecting more taxes from the people than what the government of that day had required. They were enriching themselves by keeping the extra money for themselves. But John still said God would accept even the tax collectors because God desires to pour out mercy on those who confess. And he will give them strength to live changed lives. So my brothers and sisters, as I said, we are sinners. So we have to keep on confessing our sins to God. And he will surely listen and forgive us. When the tax collectors, they came to be baptized, they asked, what should they do? John replied, do not collect extra taxes from the people. Just collect what the government requires. Be honest. Stop enriching yourselves at the expenses of your countrymen. Notice, John did not tell them to quit their jobs, only to be honest, to be sincere. John's powerful message even reached the soldiers. The Jewish soldiers served to help keep the peace. They also had a privileged position, like the tax collectors, over the common people, and they used their powers on the people, sometimes taking their money and accusing them of doing things that they did not do. They were told by John to control their greed and be contented with their salary. You know, many persons, they are not contented with their salary, with their wages, and they will do things to get more. Things that is not right. My brothers and sisters, we are to be contented, as John told the soldiers. Contentment grows from an attitude towards living God's way. If we are contented, we will always focus on what God has already allowed us to have. We must disregard what we do not have. We must stop covet, want what others have. We must give thanks to God for each and all of his gifts. Of course, this is giving time, giving season, Christmas. And many of you will be looking for gifts from different people, forgetting that we had a hard 2 years. So if you do not get that gift, don't vex. Be contented with what you have. If we fail to make these decisions, we are not contented. To be contented is one of the key of spiritual growth and personal fulfillment. We should honor God and center our desires on him. And we should conduct content with what God is doing in our lives. In Philippians chapter 4, 13, 11 to 13, Paul words, and he states, I am not saying this because I am in need. For I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Then he went on to say, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Strong words from Paul. We should trust our Heavenly Father for supplying all of our needs, my brothers and sisters. There are three times in life when we have empty hands. At birth, when we're born, we come out of our mother's womb with empty hands. At the time when we come to Jesus, when we come to give up our life to Jesus, we go with empty hands. And at death, we go with empty hands. Because none of you ever see anybody in a casket with their money in their hands. We brought nothing into the world. And it is certain that we can carry nothing out. As the Calypsonian said, I mentioned some time ago, you're gone, but the money stay. The money stay. Materials, possession, money, houses, clothing, vehicles, jewels, land, etc. These things remain eternally the same. They cannot last forever. We can lose them, break them, or ruin them through life. We did not bring them with us. So when we were born, we did not bring them with us, and we cannot carry anything with us when we die. As humans, we have our basic needs, such as food, clothing, and shelter for survival. And when these are met, we ought to be thankful, we ought to be satisfied, and we ought to be contented. Paul, after giving the simple plan of living faithfully, he now challenged the world's view by sharing the outcome of trying to gain contentment through the love of wealth. The desire to be rich is by its very nature a desire where you will never be satisfied or where you will never be contented. People who want to be rich cannot understand contentment because they can never have enough money. The temptation of money eventually traps people into doing anything to get money. You have a lot of money, you still want more, you want more, whether illegally or immorally, even by hurting others. People's desires for money feeds the greed, and then they will do anything to get it. People often misquote this verse in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10, by saying, money is the root of all evil, but it is the love of money that Paul speaks against. Money itself is not evil. In fact, money can do much good for the furthering of God's kingdom. Look at our sanctuary. We need money to refurbish it, so it will do well here. Money supports missionaries around the world. Money helps organizations fight for Christian causes. Money supports churches and church leaders. Money helps feed the hungry and clothe the poor. Obviously, why God doesn't need money, but still, all the money in the world belongs to him. We just borrow it for a while. All the money belongs to God. We just borrow it for a while. He can use the money given by generous people to help those in need. And these people can now give because they controlled their money. The problem happens when money controls us. So my brothers and sisters, please do not let money control you. We have to control our money. As passage of scripture read in Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 7, one of our lessons, and Paul encourages us. He encourages the church at Philippi, and this also goes for us, to be full of joy, to always be rejoicing. Imagine a man in prison behind bars and telling us, believers, to keep on rejoicing. Be joyful. Paul's attitude teaches us an important lesson. Our inner attitude do not have to reflect on our outward circumstances. Be joyful at all times and give thanks in whatever situation. Paul was full of joy because he knew that no matter what happened to him, Jesus was with him. So my brothers and sisters, Jesus is with us. Let us be joyful. We will encounter situations at times which we cannot be happy, but we can always rejoice and delight in the Lord. We should always have a spirit that is reasonable, fair-minded, and giving. And as I said, this season is a season of giving. We are motivated to joy and consideration of others by remembering that our Lord is coming soon, and the promise of our Lord's second coming encourages careful conduct by us, his followers, our lifestyle in our various communities. We are to show our gentleness to all around us and be willing to give up our own way and obey God, because he is coming back. Let me remind us that the same Christ who was crucified is the same Christ who was risen from the dead for you and for me. The same Christ who was taken up to heaven will come again to reward us whom he found watching and waiting with patience. So let us stay ready for his second coming. Jesus predicted that before his return, many believers would be misled by false teachers coming in his name that is claiming to be the Messiah. Jesus said clearly, do not believe them, because the one clear sign of Christ's return will be his unmistakable appearance in the clouds that will be seen by all people. John saw Jesus death with his own eyes, and he never forgets the horror of it. All people across the ages who have rejected Christ will face judgment. So my brothers and sisters, let me encourage us to be ready for Christ's second coming. Be prepared. Let us be loving. Let us be compassionate. Let us be contentive. And let us be giving. Jesus bears all of these qualities. And let us do likewise. Father God, we have come, we have heard your words. And Father, we thank you for contentive hearts, contentive minds, who listen to your words and who will apply your words. Father, as we go from this sanctuary, help us to be brave, to share some good words with somebody. Help us to give during this festive season, and not only this festive season, but always. Father, these we ask in order name, but your son's name. Amen. Amen.
All right, we have heard from our brother, and as we seek to respond to that word, let us all stand as we unite our voices in the singing of the hymn number 81, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. Let us all stand, please.
But we bear the end.
Amen. And my heart shall rejoice, Lord Jesus, when thou comest. Lord, as we go from this service in the church, strengthen us for service in the world, that the words of our worship will find expression in our daily life. Glory of your holy name. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us always, forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Have a blessed week. Blessed week, my brothers and sisters.